Welcome, friends, for this monthly meeting organized by ISHA, Institute for the Study of Human Awareness. The intention to have these monthly meetings is to refresh ourselves on our journey toward our spiritual goals. So these meetings are really meant for those who have a spiritual goal in their life. We all have different goals in life. And many of those goals we make for success in this physical world. But the physical life is very short compared to the cosmic time in which we live. And therefore, those are short-term goals. The afterlife is much longer. So therefore, those goals we make for what happens after we die in a form that is not physical are far more important in terms of the amount of time we have in fulfillment of those goals. The goal that I am advocating, recommending, based on my experiences in this life, are connected with our spirit, our soul, not with the physical body, not with the astral body, the imaginary body that can fly around, not even with the mind, the thinking machine. I am setting goals for the soul, the spirit of consciousness that provides life. It provides life to the physical body. It provides life to our sense perceptions. It provides life to our mind. Without consciousness, all these are dead. So our true form, or our soul, which is immortal, has no birth or death, and which is where we really want to have our eyes set now, has no birth or death, immortal, and that's where we set a goal. My idea of a good spiritual goal is to go back to the origin of the soul. Where did it come from? An individuated soul sitting individually in each one of us, creating life for us. Where is the origin of it? We get some guidance from people who have worked on this goal earlier. And those people, we call them perfect living masters, we call them mystics adept, we call them by different names. We call them Param Sat Satgurus. Whatever name you use, those people have indicated that our origin is a totality of ourself. It's a totality of our consciousness. That there is only one source, only one total consciousness from where everything is emerging and coming and manifesting. And therefore, our goal should be to reach that level. That is why what I advocate is, if as human beings, sitting in the physical body, if we can set a goal and achieve it, it'll be worthwhile to discover our origin, to discover who we really are. We are really not so many, we are one. But to say we are one is different from actually realizing where we are one. Not in the bodies, not in our minds. We are one in spirit, one in our consciousness. And that is why I set a goal for going to our totality of consciousness, which is the ultimate creative power for all our experiences. Now that is very easily said than done, because living in this world, we have identified ourselves to be this physical body because we live in a physical material world. The material world only comes into our experience when we have a material form. If we did not have a material form, there'd be no material world. Some people think there'll be still a material world even if we are not material, that the soul can be soul, but we still have a material world. Which is true? Does the material world exist by itself and we just come for a little while into this world? Or are we generating the experience of a material world by coming into this physical form? That can be tested out very easily. When we die, we'll find out if the material world is still there or some other world has opened up. If we die and find that a material world was only created while we were material, that will be a big shock to us. Now, when you die and find that out, you can't help anybody else. You are dead. other people can't benefit from your experience, that you found out the reality, the truth. But there's another way to do it. And that's called dying while living. You can die while you're still living and tell other people what happened. Help them to understand and make them also die while living. Dying while living is a simple spiritual meditational process. We do meditation for that purpose, really, to discover what is beyond this life, beyond this physical experience. Dying while living is achieved in the same way as death leads to that experience. When we physically die in our bodies, what happens? We don't have too much evidence of people telling us what happens. Some evidence is there. We see people in terminal hospices dying. We can sit near them and listen to them what they are experiencing. If people are dying slowly, they can explain to us that they first lose the awareness of their hands and feet. That means death seems to be a progressive thing on the physical body. They first don't know where their hands and feet have gone. Then they don't know where their arms and legs have gone. Then they don't know where the torso is going from the bottom upwards. They're still speaking to us and telling us, I'm flying. They're not flying. They just lost the consciousness of their bottom. I don't know, put my leg this side. I think it's paining. It's already in that side. They don't know where it is. This loss of consciousness, loss of awareness of their body gradually taking place till it goes upwards and they can't speak when they reach the throat. They're speechless, but they're knowing they're dying. They can't tell us anything. Then they move up and when they reach the brain is dead, they're dead. The physical body is gone. This process of consciousness moving away, the awareness moving away from their extremity right up to the head, and giving them the experience of death, actual physical death, can be simulated, replicated artificially. It can be, same thing can be done while we are alive. And that would be called dying while living. In the Bible we see Paul says, I die daily. Surely not talking physical death, he's talking about experience. This experience of dying while living has been able to furnish so much information to us of what happens when we actually die physically. Now, how do we achieve this? Through meditation. By meditating on the self in the brain, in the head. When we are awake in the physical body, our awareness is operating from the head. We don't feel we are sitting in our arms and legs, we are sitting behind the eyes. We look at the world through our eyes. We listen to the world through our ears. We think about the world with our brain. All these activities of life are taking place from a focal point in the head behind the eyes. That exact position where we seem to be operating as units of consciousness or life has been called the third eye center, or the point of consciousness, or the center of consciousness. Or some people just called it the point. And sometimes we just call it, in other languages, the nukta. We sometimes call it the eye that looks into the inner sky. It doesn't matter what we call it. The point is, when we are alive and awake in the physical body, if we close our eyes and contemplate that if we are not the body, where are we sitting inside the body? Where are we functioning as a thinking machine, as a thinking person? Where do we function from? It doesn't take too long to find out. It's somewhere in the head, most likely behind the eyes. And what we can do by meditation is to meditate upon that point. Meditate means to contemplate, to think about, to work about, to somehow put your attention there. If we can put our attention on the third eye center behind the eyes, what will happen? People have tried very successfully that when they put their attention and think of nothing else but what is inside their head behind the eyes, they slowly don't know where their hands and feet have gone. They don't know then where their legs have gone. They don't know where their torso has gone. They feel like they're flying lighthearted. They have no gravity left. All these experiences which happen in real physical death take place while you're doing that meditation at the third eye center. So that's a good way to be able to experience. If you are able to pull your whole attention and become totally unaware of your body, you'll find you still have a form. You still have consciousness. You still have thinking. You still have all those things which you associated with this body. And yet you can step away, move away, fly into the skies, do all those things, leaving this consciousness of the body behind. You don't actually leave the body. You get an experience of moving away from the body. It's just an experience because the body is alive. It's not dead. The body is alive. The heart is functioning properly. All vital signs are there. And you are having an experience of unawareness of the body. This ability in a human being to deliberately create an unawareness of its form and lead to an experience of another form, insight, great blessing, great gift to us. And that is how we can find out that this body is not our real form. We are sitting inside it and using it for a certain small length of time. People live 50, 100, 200, maybe not, nobody lives 200 even. Even 100 is only some people achieve, 100 years. It's a very short time in terms of billions of years that this planet is supposed to have been here. And trillions of years since the universe was created, 100 years means nothing. If we set a clock and think that the world was created at 12 o'clock, and now it's 20 minutes past 5, that's one of the calculations, we'll be dead in 1 minute. So the time frame is so short in a physical life. If we are able to withdraw our attention from the physical body and become fully aware of our inner form, what do we find? Wonderful things. One, we can still see better than we can see with physical eyes. Two, we can hear better than with our ears. Three, we have the tactile touch and we have the smell and we have all sense perceptions intact. That's amazing. And we can do that, you know, in meditation sessions which I have. I make you see the flowers and take a drink and make you eat snacks, all without the use of the physical body, and you have good sense perceptions of that. Sense perceptions are kept absolutely intact and better in a body that resides inside the physical body. So we sometimes call it the astral body. Why call it astral body? Because it's a body that has no gravity and can fly into the sky. Astral refers to its ability to fly into the sky. All sense perceptions are not only intact, they are the form of the body. If you can put those sense perceptions in the same place as this physical body that constitutes the astral body, it doesn't have any matter. It has no atoms or molecules in it. It has sense perceptions. But it has the brain of the astral self inside. The astral mind works just like this mind works, little better. It has little better memory. Our memory is very short in the physical brain. We can't remember what breakfast we had last week. We can't remember except a very few events of childhood. And we can't remember or hardly anything of our previous lives. But that is not true in the astral self. You have much longer memory. You can remember what happened 400 years ago. Because 400 years ago, you still had the same astral body. Not a different one. You had different physical bodies. But the astral self was still the same. This ability to recall personally your own events of a life way before the birth of this physical body gives you an insight into the greater reality of the inner body compared to the physical body. That astral body has a much longer life. You may have many forms of physical type during the period of one astral life. Therefore, it's a great event to be able to die while living and discover that death does not mean the end of existence. Death means the end of the existence of the physical body and your awakening of the inner body, which has a much longer life and may reincarnate again in another physical body. These discoveries are very useful for us to put our priorities right, that we are giving so much importance to the physical body, that's very temporary compared to even the inner body. But that is just one step. It is only one step toward the goal that I am talking of, the goal of finding the totality of consciousness, our origin of the soul. We haven't even reached the soul. The soul is still giving power to the astral body and to the mind. But we can go further with some help, how to meditate with the inner body. If we meditate with the inner body, process is the same. The sense that where you are in the inner body is exactly the same location as in the physical body behind the eyes of the inner body. If you meditate behind the eyes of the inner body, you are able to withdraw the attention from even the inner body. Same process, no difference. It's all withdrawal of attention. You withdraw attention to the third eye center of the inner body, which is the same place as the third eye center of this body. When you withdraw attention there, you gradually become unaware even of your astral body. Then what happens? You discover that there were no forms. You don't need a form to have an existence. You can exist just as consciousness with one little instrument with you called the human mind, the thinking mind. You can still think with no sense perceptions, with no physical body. You can still think. You can have direct perception of all senses together with the mind, without splitting them up into seeing, touching, tasting, and making them separate. You get a state of being in which you get experiences from where the creation is taking place of these worlds, astral, physical, and so on. It's a great experience. And the biggest experience comes at that level when you discover that your mind, which you thought was separate, we all have separate minds, had one single source. That all the minds of all the universes that are being created, they're drawing the power of thinking, power of rationalizing, power of making sense of their experiences from one source. You might refer to that as the universal mind. When you have that experience, and this is being done with your effort, because you are meditating. You can't meditate if you don't want to do it. You have to put in an effort to meditate. So with your effort, by meditating within this physical body, by meditating within the astral body, you can reach a state of awareness in which you realize that you are consciousness being helped to have experience through a thing called mind. So the mind itself has been called the causal body. It causes all other experiences to happen. It's the cause of everything. Our mind is the cause of creation of all the three worlds that we are experiencing. And it's not one mind. It's a universal mind creating all minds. Most people who wanted to go to the truth of their oneness have discovered the universal mind and said, that's the oneness we were looking for. They couldn't go any further because with their effort for the mind, all effort is made by the mind. In the effort of the mind, they meditated. They were able to become unaware of the physical body, became aware of the astral sensory body, became aware of their causal self, that the mind was still able to think and create. Mind was able to conceptualize, make a concept into ideas through senses and put them out as a physical world. The mind was doing everything. Mind was the creator. The universal mind is the creator of every universe we are aware of. Therefore, the journey ended there. Great mystics, great philosophers, great saints have come and called that the end of their journey and declared it as such. Because there was no way to find out if there was something beyond the mind. They thought the mind was producing consciousness. They didn't know that the consciousness was producing a living mind That if the consciousness was pulled out, the mind would die. They didn't know that. Many people who have done great experimental work on consciousness have been stuck there by thinking, mind, soul, maybe it's the same thing. Maybe consciousness came from mind, mind came from consciousness, whatever it is, it's the same thing. But it's not. The reason is simple. The mind that they are using is always functioning in a very limited sphere called space, time, and causation. Mind cannot transcend that. There is no mind, there is no thought that can take place without first having time and space and causation. Mind has been sometimes called as the product of these three. Immanuel Kant describes the mind as just a categories of these three categories put together makes the mind. So many philosophers have thought about it that without space and time, thoughts cannot exist. And thoughts are the primary function of the mind. If there is no thinking, there is no mind. And yet, we don't need to think. Even in daily life, in the physical body, we are not always thinking to make decisions. Sometimes we have what is called a gut feeling, an intuitive feeling, no thought. Suddenly we say, I know it. This is to be done. Mind says no. I say, no, I know it. How do you know it? Where did this knowledge come from? Where the mind is thinking and giving you different reason and different answer, and some gut feeling in you saying, no, that's not it. Where does intuition come from? It involves no thought. Therefore, it involves no time. How can there be something functioning in us, even here, and at all levels, where we can do things where no thinking is involved, no time and space is involved? The truth is that our soul, pure consciousness, neither needs time, nor needs space, nor needs causation to exist and to function. That's what we call the soul. Therefore, to go beyond the mind and discover the soul, that's our reality, very few people have done. Even in history, very few people have done that. I want to set that as the primary goal. If we have to function, at least we should discover who we are beyond space and time, and providing life to the mind, to the senses, and to the body, that must be our real self. If we stay in the universal mind causal state for a while, we find we created all the memories. We don't remember, we create remembrance. Memories are being created there. And you can create any type of memories. And what's the significance of that? When you create a set of memories, you create a life. You say we pack a set of memories from childhood to death of a person. And then we play it out. We make a little DVD or a capsule and put the memories of a lifetime. And then we bring it down to the astral plane and play it out there. Then a little part of it we play it down physical plane. We're creating our destinies. Destiny is not made by any other means except our universal mind. Mind makes our destiny. I'll explain to you how it has to be made there and can't be made here. A memory means something that has happened. To say something has happened, it requires time. Nothing can happen without time. You can't say something happened and there was no time. How can it happen without time? Therefore, it needs time. Do we have time? At least let's start from here. In the physical plane, do we have time? We live constantly, without break, in a time called now. And some people are teaching us, live in the now, live in the now. I say, where are we living? I haven't met anybody who's not living in the now. By very force of nature, we can live nowhere else except now. We are all living in no other time frame except now. And let me tell you, now has no time at all. Now is a meeting point between the past and the future. The moment I start uttering the word now, it's past. I can't speak a single word in the now. I can't do anything in the now. Whatever I'm doing is immediate past. So by mistake, we are mistakenly calling the immediate past as present. There's no present. There's no now. Not in terms of time. If now has no time, and we're living in no time, how would we say we are living and we remember everything? Think of it. Only by the use of memory. Whether it's a memory of 1 second ago, 1 hour ago, 1 day, a lifetime, or previous lifetimes. It's all memory that's making us feel we are living in the now, living in the present. We are indeed living in the past, recalling it through memory. Therefore, we are not living now. We are living in a memory. And memory has to be done what has already happened and is stored somewhere and bring it back. That's where you will find out the answer to this strange question. Past is gone and you can only recall it through memory. There's no other way. No other way to remember even 1 second old event except through memory. It's a play of memory. So present is not really time. It's past. And past is past anyway. What about future? Future is only created by us, by a function in the past. What is that function? Hope. I hope this happens. Now, when you say that, I hope this happens, it's happening in the past. You use so many words, they can't be in the now. I hope it happens, and suddenly a future comes up. Or fear. I'm afraid this will happen. Future is created. Or anticipate, neutral. They are all neutral. This is going to happen. Whether it's hope or fear or anticipation, these are merely functions of recovering the memory from the recent past. The future is the past. Present is past. Past is past. If everything is past, how can you experience it except through memory? You are living your destiny through memory. Right now and at all times. Whether it's here, in the astral plane, causal plane, or anywhere. You're living these recall of memories in so sharp and created through sense perception, projection of the sense perceptions to an outward screen, multidimensional outward screen. It looks real. Something is happening here. It's an amazing way. You can discover this just by going, withdrawing your attention to the place where memories are being made. Memories are being turned out in nanoseconds. And enough memories to make billion trillions of lives and all stored there. Sometimes we describe the storage space as a sky. They say akashic records, akashic records, that those records are up, lying up in the sky. Of course they're lying up there. It's just a description that they are all lying there. And who makes the choice what destiny to pick? The soul. The conscious self. The moment the conscious self picks up a particular recorded destiny of one life, the laws of cause and effect come into being. The laws of time and space come into being. Events must be placed in time and space. So it's a prerequisite for memories to be played out at the causal plane to have a platform of time and space in advance to put the events on it. So we create a huge timeline. Past, present, future, there's timeline. We put ourselves in the center. Then we start remembering from the center and going backwards. How do we move from one event to another? In a destiny being created through memories, we have to now make a connection to make a smooth life, like it's a continuous period of time spent here. That's where the law of cause and effect comes into being. We make each event a cause and an effect. It's a cause for a future event. It's an effect of a previous event. That's how events are then placed on timeline. And thus is born a great law, the law of karma, law of cause and effect. And everything being created here is now based upon law of karma in all the three worlds. A remarkable way to do it. That consciousness can design this is the most amazing design I can ever think of. But perfect. perfect for its purpose, to create experiences that look real in a space-time continuum, and to place events like that to connect each other with cause and effect and say this happened because, or the cause was, and we look at the cause. But then we are starting a life. How can we have a cause when it's only one life? So we create the memory of a past life. And to sustain the past life, we create a memory of a still past life. How many lives do we have to create in order to sustain under the law of cause and effect, under the law of karma? One life has to be created by creating infinite past lives. And therefore, one life we live here has to be infinite future lives. People say, if we were souls and we came into this world, we had no karma. How did we get the karma to start with? We had no past lives. We just came first time. Where does karma come from? Karma came from the package of memories for one life. And that one life carried with it the blueprint of lives we never lived. They were our past lives. We come here, they become real past lives to create the current life. We say you had so many past lives, maybe you never lived them, but they were there. They were there in the memory package, but you never lived them. You don't know how many you lived, because you could have lived one and then moved to the next. And so many past lives and so many future lives are all there on the same package, because the law of karma requires that there should be cause and effect. Therefore, there's past lives and future lives attached to it. This is a pattern. And this looks like a wonderful package, but it's wonderful to go and study it. To go and study, look at that Akash where these are being stored. Look at the way we make these choices. Look at the way we make choices where we think, why did we, today sitting here, we can say, why did I make such a bad choice to be falling sick here and to be poor and to have so many hardships and to go to prison for something? Why did I pick up that if I decided to have the memory myself? There must be a reason for that. Where we picked up any particular destiny. We were not so stupid not to realize what kind of life we are picking up. The reason why we could pick up any life without bothering is because it was merely a play of memory. It's like going to a movie. When you go and see a movie, horrible movies we see, we are not affected by them. In fact, we enjoy them. Ups and downs take place, murders take place, all things happen. We say, oh, very good movie. That's what we said when we came here. We're going to see a very good movie. But once we got in, this was not the kind of movie where we sit in the audience and watch on the screen. This was a movie where we decided to sit with one of the characters, to be close to the movie. We picked up any character. We didn't bother. Let's pick up a nice king or a president or somebody like that. Let's pick a rich person to sit in that brain. Any brain is good enough to see the movie. Which reminds me of a book called The Canterbury Tales by Geoffrey Chaucer. Geoffrey Chaucer wrote that book in the 18th century. And that book is considered to be very important in English literature. It's supposed to be the beginning of the novel. The difference between drama and novel was that in novel you can show the character of person. In drama you couldn't. The king was always a king. He couldn't be a nasty king or a jealous king or something. Those came in the novel. This is the first book of a story in which character has been introduced. It's a story about 40-50 pilgrims walking, driving all the way in a carriage or on horseback or on foot to Canterbury for pilgrimage. Just to pass the time, it's a long time to walk there, to pass the time, they're telling stories to each other. They're reciting poems, songs, singing songs, just to entertain each other. And as they entertain each other, the author, who is Chaucer, he describes each of them with a character. For example, he talks of an attorney, a lawyer. He says about the lawyer, a busier man than there never was. Or what he says is, in old English, a busier man than him there nors. Nors means never was. And yet he seemed busier than he was. looks like a modern attorney. This was the first time a character could be described like this. Or a woman traveling with them, a wife of Bath. Bath is a town in England. The wife of Bath is traveling with them, and he described when the wife's turn comes to speak, and there was this woman of Bath. Husbands at Kirk, she had 5. Husbands at church, she had 5. Without an other company of youth, in youth, but that of need not speak now. He had 5 husbands, but other company in young age she had. I don't want to talk about that. It's a characterization. As it happens, in that book, Chaucer says, I was also amongst them. And he is also walking with them. And then in the middle of the book, the other people say, Chaucer, you are a great poet. You've written great poetry. You've written songs. You've written good stories. Come tell us some nice poem. And Chaucer says, I don't know any poetry. The man who's written the whole book, as a character, says, I don't know anything. They insist, no, we know you are a good author and you can tell us some nice song or story. And he comes out with the worst doggerel rhyme in the whole book. And everybody criticizes him. Oh, we expected better from you. This question has been asked. Why did the author of the book, who could have put himself in any character he liked, why did he put himself in a character where he was crucified by his own people, his own creation? This has been compared with the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. If he was Son of God, one with his Father, how was he crucified by his own creation? Why was Chaucer crucified by his own creation? Answer was simple in both cases. Jesus Christ was not a man. He was totality. He was everybody. Chaucer was not one character in the book. He was all the characters. He wrote all the characters. When you are all the characters, it hardly matters which character you walk into. Therefore, when you decide, the soul decides to come into this universe and can sit so close to the action, so close to the movie, so close to drama, it puts itself in one of the characters. We are now sitting in one of the characters of the movie, which we picked up ourselves. It doesn't matter which character we picked. It's all going to end the same way, and we are going to discover we created a nice movie, play, drama, life for ourselves, and we watched it so closely by sitting in one of the characters there, and now we come back and left the mind behind, left everything behind. We were the soul. We had nothing to do with all this. Don't forget, this law of karma, cause and effect, has been created at the mind level. There is no karma. There is no law of like this kind on the soul at all. Soul has never had any karma. Why? It has no time. Karma requires time. Soul is beyond time. Therefore, there is no karma. It's all in the mind. It's all created on the mind. So when we picked up a destiny in which we placed ourselves in one of the characters, it didn't matter which character. We did take into account one little thing. And that's why I remind you, sitting here, you all took care of that. Otherwise, you wouldn't be sitting here. Now, what was that special feature that attracted you to pick up that particular destiny that has made you come and sit in this audience today? That characteristic was, you looked at the package, how many lives you want to live, and you found that at a certain point, when you think you have had enough of the drama, you made a choice for yourself to get out of it. And you picked the life like this, that it should run on the basis of cause and effect, karma. But when you are tired of this karma, you should be able to get out. And therefore, you placed yourself in a life which you saw in the package, where at a certain point in time, you could get out by creating yourself in a position where in your show, a character will appear who will tell you time to go home and tell you that's the way to go home. No character, you play as the character there. You picked up the whole show by picking up a life where you will want to go back home, want to go out of this mess, you had enough of it, and you want to go back home. So a person will appear in that movie, in that life, who will say, time to go back home. That's the way to go back home. And you think that person is separate from you. In the movie, it is separate. But it's not separate at the top. It's only one. You created that design for yourself. That is why you picked up a particular package. It's looked up and down and all that. But so what? After so much time, I've already made arrangements to go back home. Good package. Very wise decision. The soul is not so stupid. It knows when to want to go back home and made the arrangement itself. It's like in the movie called Inception, people can go into dreams and they take a totem in their hand to be able to wake up. When they're tired of what is going on, they can wake up. We got a totem in our hand. And the totem is called the appearance in one of our lifetimes when we are ready of a human being like ourselves, whom we can call a friend, in whom we can place trust, who says, let's go home. This is the very raison d'etre of the appearance of a perfect living master. Perfect living master is not somebody other than ourselves. And if during the play, a lot of people come and say, we'll help you with this, they're part of the play. A perfect living master never says, follow me, never says, go to that place for pilgrimage, never says the truth lies outside. He continuously tells us the real message, the truth is inside you. He even tells you, he who you are seeing outside is also inside you. Outside is just a reflection. You want to see who the master is, go inside you. Nothing is outside, including the master. It's all inside. So he pushes you inside. Unlike others who say, come out, we'll show you some drama, some more drama over here. So that is why the perfect living master, when he comes here, he represents yourself in a state beyond the mind. That's where you want to go. The drama starts from the mind, and the truth of your own being is the soul beyond the mind. Now that's the whole issue here. How can one go beyond the mind? Can we do it without effort? Clear answer, no. Why? Because all effort is from the mind. How can you go beyond the mind using the mind? It's like this. A stray dog comes on the stage and I say, shoo, shoo, it doesn't go. I take its tail and hit him with the tail to get him out. How will he go out? I'm holding his tail. If we are holding our mind to get out of the mind, how will he go out? We can't use the mind to get out of the mind. And all effort, no matter what, is all with the mind. Therefore, to go beyond the mind requires something else. That's an interesting point. What can we have which can go beyond the mind? It must be something that exists beyond the mind. Our soul is beyond the mind. Our soul can pull us, maybe. But the soul is trying to get out of the mind. So we need something to pull us. We can't push. We pushed far enough when we reached the universal mind. We can't push anymore. Nobody has ever done that. And by very means of the definition of these things, nobody can. Therefore, we need a pull from the other side. How do we get the pull? What is the pull? How do we say pull of consciousness? When I think of this as a concept, I think of pull of consciousness, I can think of no other word than the pull of love. Love pulls us. Love pulls us here. Love pulls us inside. Love pulls us beyond the mind. We don't push to get love. Love pulls us even here. Do you know if there is no pull from somebody, we can't love that person? There has to be some pull. There can be no lover without a signal from the beloved. In fact, one Persian mystic says this. Ishq awwal dar dile mashuk paida mishwat. That love is first born in the heart of the beloved. The beloved gives a signal, a smile or something, and you're pulled. Even here and everywhere. If this is true, that the nature of love that it can pull, then what pulls us beyond the mind is love. Nothing else. Pure, unconditional love, not mixed up with attachments, not mixed up with infatuations, not mixed up with sexual desires, not mixed up with anything physical like we talk about, and we call it love. Unconditional, pure spiritual love from the spirit can pull us. Do we have to wait till we reach universal mind to get pulled up, or can we start earlier? We can start right from here. Now, when we say we placed in our life, when we want to go back home, a totem called the perfect living master, the perfect living master must be the source of that pull right here. And that's exactly how it works. A perfect living master comes into our life not to teach. What will he teach? These subjects we are talking about are all published in books. And there are thousands of teachers teaching this thing. Thousands of them. A perfect living master comes into our life not for teaching, but to take us back home, according to our agreed program. He does not come for anything else except to pull us with love beyond the mind. Sole purpose. No other mandate, only to pull us with his unconditional, pure spiritual love beyond the mind. That's his job. We, identifying ourselves with the mind, are questioning. What is he doing? Is he telling us something worthwhile? He's teaching nothing. He's no good. So become the teacher for us. He's saying that, no, you have to be effortless. You have to be pulled. We have to do nothing. Nothing comes without pull, without struggle, without work, without trying. How can a man say, without trying, you'll go somewhere? You must try. It's okay. Meditate. Meditate. Follow the directions. Rules. Oh, mind loves rules. Mind loves rules. Mind loves classification. Mind loves 1, 2, 3, 4. That loves that. If that is not there, the mind won't work. Oh, you know, there are several heavens. This physical plane, astral plane, causal plane, spiritual plane, total 5 levels. Oh, mind says, there must be something true. There are no 5 levels. There's only 1 level. It's 1 level totality, every show taking place inside it. But we mind won't follow that. I remember long ago, I was in college, and there was election going on for the college union, students union, president of the students union. There's government college in Ludhiana long ago. I was a newcomer there, but I stood for that election. And people had great speeches made, other candidates. I said, this won't work. I knew that the mind likes classification. So I wrote out a paper, 10 points. Point 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10. And when other people finished their speeches, I fortunately was the last one. I said, these are useless speeches. They have no points for you. Here are my 10 points. I was elected president. And I know it. I'm telling you, the mind's attitude towards numbers and classification, it loves it. Analyze, separate, and you love it. I was once working in a tribal area in India as part of my job. I was chairman of a project called Dandakarne Project, where they were settling refugees from Bangladesh would come into India, and I was made in charge of that as part of my job. And they were some of them very violent people. They were resisting settlement in those tribal areas. So my predecessor had even been attacked by those people for not giving them enough. So I went and I said, I am like you people, I am also displaced. So they set up a little coordination with me. One night I went to a very remote tribal area to talk to them. And I took with me the directors and the heads of different departments. I took my civil engineer, chief engineer, took the director of health. I took the all kinds of departments, agriculture, so that whatever they will ask, I'll have the people ready to work for them. So I went, I reached very late at night. About 300 people, tribals were waiting, including those resettlers, everybody was waiting. And I said, what would you like to have? Why do you want me to be here with you? They said, we have a list of 15 points. So they gave me a list. We want schools here. We want health services here. We want medical attention here. We want water supply here. We want irrigation here. Whatever they had, 15 mundane points of their better living conditions. So I spoke to them. They could understand my language. I spoke to a translator. I translated. I said, these 15 points, you don't need me for that. Here is the director of education, set up schools tomorrow. Here's the chief engineer, he'll build roads tomorrow for you. Here's the health guy, he will do the hospitals. All the people are right here. They can do all these 15 things. I have not come for that. I have come here, and the translator was translating me. I have come here, points 16 and 17, which is not even in your list. And all 300 nodded their heads. Let me tell you, till today, I don't know what 16 and 17 are. I'm telling you how the mind reacts to points. Classification. So the mind is busy in this thing. And we make a perfect living master talk to us in these terms. We love it. Our response to his love is through these means. Oh, that was very good what he explained. And he explained so well, point by point. Perfect living master don't come for these points. But they have to use the points for our sake. They become teachers for our sake because our mind likes to be taught. Not they have to be, they don't care. Inside they have a smile in their head. Look, the little children, how they are wanting these petty things like teaching and learning and meditating and all that. It's not necessary. What is necessary? To enjoy, relax in the perfect, unconditional love of a master. And remember, the masters never judge. Our mind always judges. They never say, be good and we will help you. Never. They look at our karma and they say they are trapped so badly. How can we judge them? My own master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawant Singh, picture here you can see. Once a man came in the evening. We were all sitting. I was sitting around, some 10, 15 people sitting around him. A man came running to him. He said, Master, forgive me. You told me not to drink alcohol. You told me not to eat meat. You told me not to womanize and be of moral character. You gave me instructions. I broke all the rules last night. I was in bad company. I did everything bad. Please forgive me. And great master looks at him and he says, okay, you're forgiven. Don't do it again. And the man ran away. Thank you, thank you, thank you, ran away. His own secretary sitting there and advisor sitting to great master are surprised. They say, Master, this man broke all your rules and he did not follow anything and just comes to you and says, forgive me, and you say, forgiven. What if the man does this again and comes to you? Will you still forgive him? He said, I think I'll still forgive him. Master, when will you punish him? He says, his own mind is punishing him so much. You didn't see that? His own mind is punishing him. His guilt is punishing him more. Please keep me on the side of forgivers, not punishers. These perfect living masters have a characteristic. They're always forgivers. They realize where we are. They realize our karma. They realize we are trapped. They are not going to increase the severity of our trap. They are trying to relieve it. Therefore, they are never judging us for good and bad. They are only looking at one thing. This soul, not the mind, body and senses. This soul is ready to go back home. I have come to take him at the appointed time when they are ready. Period. Their love is so unconditional. So unconditional. If you love them, they will love you. If you don't love them, they will still love you. If you hate them, they will still love you. If you kill them, they will still love you. That's the kind of love a perfect living master as a human being shows here. So it's a very exceptional experience. As we get to know that person in our life, we discover this strange pull. It's the same pull that will ultimately take us beyond the mind. Because love, total knowledge without thought, intuitive knowledge, which is total knowledge, and total bliss, a state of utter happiness, which we find in small short period here is all part of our totality. It's not part of our mind. Love is not part of our mind. Love comes from the soul, even here, even higher up, everywhere. When the, not love that you force on somebody, not the transaction love, whatever, like a business transaction. I love you, what have you done for me? What have you done for me lately, like they say. Or, I love that person so much, and look what he did to me. That's not love. That's a business transaction. I do something for you, you do for me. You call it love. Or to be attached to things. I love my house so much. I love my car. I love all these people. Attachments. And attachment cannot be love. I'll tell you simple difference between attachment and love. In attachment, you don't forget yourself. You are attached. You know you are there. You love somebody. You are attached to somebody. The self, the ego comes first. Then the person you say, I love, or the thing that you say, I love. When you say, I love my car, I can tell you, you love I more than the car. Otherwise, you can't say, I love the car. I love my children. You love yourself. In true love, you forget I. You think only of the beloved. The space that you put for your ego is pushed back in your head. The beloved occupies you. The beloved, you think of the beloved all the time. That's love. Love is the only thing that I have noticed in this physical world which can push the ego behind. Otherwise, ego is always in front. And ego is a very useful device. The mind is a useful device, but we don't use it properly. When we use the ego, I, to separate ourselves from everybody else, we are in trouble. Because the ego, I-ness, divides us. I am separate, you are separate. I am separate, they are all separate. So it divides us. If you put the ego aside, we are all one, even by putting ego aside. When you love somebody, you forget the difference between the two. In attachment, there's always feeling of two, I and you. In ego, it's you, 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 I is forgotten. In love, it's the other way. It's I is finished. I is only in ego, only in attachments. We are calling attachments as love. But if you want to experience true unconditional love, where there is no such thing, you'll have an experience with the perfect living masters. You will forget yourself. That response, now we always talk of love and devotion. We don't say love, we say love and devotion. What is the use of these two words that you put them together all the time? Love comes from the person who's in spiritual state like a perfect living master, automatically. Our response to it is called devotion. We always respond automatically. That's devotion. Devotion is a response to true love. And we get devoted when we have experience of true love. So that is how these two, love and devotion, go together. The secret of going beyond the mind is love and devotion. Period. Perfect living masters come only to give us that experience. We have the experience, we go back home. The rest is all made up temporarily while we are here. We are in the causal stage, we are in the astral stage. We have experiences, we go through those experiences. It's nice to go through the experiences, there's nothing wrong with it. Now we are living in this physical world. Half the time we laugh and half the time we cry. Some things are good, some things are bad. I have not seen any life so far that a person can say it's always good. And I've never seen any life person says it's always bad. Some moments of great pleasure, joy, happiness, some moments of depression, despair, and unhappiness, suffering. Life is made up like that. Why should human life be made up of a mixture of these two? There's a good reason for that. It's a pattern established by the law of cause and effect. That this physical world is not the only place where we manifest ourselves. Physical world is just one of the places. Very important place though. There are other places we call heavens and hells. They exist in the astral plane. You can go and check them out. People have gone and checked them out. Both heavens and hells exist. Those places give you experiences of intense pleasure for a long time, or intense pain for a long time. Intense happiness and joy over some events taking place there, and intense suffering because of torture going on there. And they have been well described, those places. If you had a good karma, all good actions justifying, good result, you'd go to heaven. If you have all bad actions, you'd go to hell. You'll go through heaven or hell and suffer or enjoy, come back. What is the unique thing about this physical life in a human body, which is not hell or heaven, is it's a combination of the two. It's between the two. By making a combination, we get the gateway to going to a true home through a perfect living master. How does a human life become a gateway? Because in human life alone, we have a unique experience called free will, the ability to make a choice, or at least the feeling that we can make a choice. If everything is predetermined on the timelines, if everything is already in the memory, you can't change it. We go to see a movie and we say, now what's going to happen? Because we are looking in the screen. What could happen next? What's going to happen is already happened at the back in the film. The film is preloaded, pre-shot, preloaded. It's being shown to us. We deliberately don't want to look at that. We want to look at the drama part of it. What's going to happen next? And we think anything can happen. Those people are making choices there. This ability to make choices is based upon ignorance of the future. We have a great blessing called ignorance. Ignorance of the future. If we have knowledge of the future, you would have no free will. You would find that what you're thinking and making decisions are already made the same way. Therefore, this ability of having an experience called free will or making a choice enables us to have the experience of becoming a seeker. We won't be able to seek even the truth. Seeking is not the same thing as a desire. Somebody wrote to me the other day that you say desires are all attachments here, and seeking our true home, seeking God, is also a desire. I said no. The two words have a different meaning and connotation altogether. Desire arises from the mind. Seeking arises from the soul. Seeking comes from the same point where intuition comes from. Seeking comes from the same place where love comes from. I have met people who lived their whole life, are in their 60s and 70s and come to me, and they have lived their desires in life, fulfilled. When they meet me, they say, from childhood we had a seeking to go where you are telling us now. Nobody knew. The one guy who came, his brother didn't know at all. His own close brother didn't know. He was a seeker. He said, from childhood I've been seeking. This suddenly seeking opens up. It is not expressed as desire. Desires are mental, and desires are mostly for things which the mind craves through sense perceptions outside of our system, not inside. Therefore, seeking is different. To seek, the feeling must come, I can seek, I want to seek. And that's the use of free will. A human being has been endowed with that special gift of being able to feel, I am seeking. And when you seek, you will find. That's the truth. Seeking is the secret of opening the door to your own soul and to your totality of consciousness. And seeking comes into our heart, into our consciousness, through the soul and not through thinking through the mind. Nobody seeks through the mind. We desire through the mind. We desire things. Seeking is almost there all the time. In fact, if you look at your own lives, you'll find that something beyond the mind you were seeking all the time. Is it not a thought? Where was it? Still in your consciousness. So this particular human life is the greatest gift. It has been said man is made in the image of the Creator. It doesn't mean the Creator has face and has got eyes and face like us. Creator is formless. Then what is the similarity? How can we say man is made in the image of the Creator, of God Himself? Man is made in the image of God. What is common between the two? What is common is God has totality of consciousness, has total free will to design the whole show. And we have the feeling we can design the whole show. God has real free will and we have the illusion of free will. But free will is common in the two. And that is similarity, no other similarity. This is a great, it's a very great gift to us to be able to feel we can seek and we can do something. And that's what leads to our going to our true home. It is seeking that brings a perfect living master into our life. We can't find one. There's no way we can find. Supposing somebody says, I can find who's a perfect living master, that must be perfect living master himself. Because unlike other teachers, unlike people who have achieved something and are trying to show off what they have achieved, perfect living masters never do that. They come as ordinary people. Sometimes more ordinary than ordinary people. And why do they have to be so ordinary? They can come little extraordinary, something different from us. No, because if they're little different from us, they can't be our friends. And friendship is a sign of love. If a master cannot be a friend, he cannot be a master. Period. A master is a friend first, a master afterwards. A good friend of mine, a great disciple of this man, whose stories abound now, Dr. Ishwar C, the veterinarian doctor, who really loved his master beyond measure. So many stories about him. He told that Satguru is yaar pehle, guru baad mein. He's a friend first, he's a master afterwards. If he can't be a friend, we can't experience his unconditional love. Therefore, he comes as a friend. And to be a friend, you have to be at the same level. Now that's another characteristic you will notice in perfect living masters. A very simple person comes, he finds the master to be a very simple person. A top philosopher starts to come, intellectual stuff, the master becomes intellectual, start talking like that. A person who's poor comes and the master is acting poor. Rich person comes, master is also rich. Where is the adaptability coming in? The adaptability is to match with the disciple and have the level of friendship that is required on this path. So that is why this is a unique relationship and a relationship that we have planned and created at inception, the very beginning of the universe. We have come here. Why did we come this kind of world? This is a world of pairs of opposites, duality. Here we have pain and pleasure, light and darkness, happiness, unhappiness. Why should we choose a life that has got these pairs like that? Couldn't we design a better world than this? If we are the designers of this universe, couldn't we make it better than having this duality and pairs of opposites? A good question. Answer is also good. The answer is, an experience in time and space cannot be had if you have no opposite of it. If somebody has no unhappiness and says, I am happy, it has no value. It's all comparison. If there was light, a certain amount of light, which was always there, whether we close our eyes, open our eyes, whether it's night or day, if a certain light was there, we would never have seen it. Nobody would have seen it, nobody would have called it anything. The darkness that created the experience of light. Everything that we are having experience in these worlds is based upon pairs of opposites. The experience in this kind of generated universe is based on pairs of opposites. Okay, that's all right to create experience through opposites. How does it serve when we go back home? It serves because our home has no pairs of opposites. Our true home, our Sachkhand, has no pairs of opposites. There's no duality there. Therefore, how can we have experience of our true home if we have never seen a world of duality? By creating a world of duality, we made it a pair of opposites. Good reason to have a creation. Good reason to have a creation based upon duality to make our own non-duality into a pair of opposites. Did a good job. This is basic. This is very basic to creation. That we could create something that made us experience our own home better. And in a story form, they tell that we are so many souls living in our true home, enjoying. And they described in some literature a bunce. And the souls have come here when they return, they're called Hans. And the bunce and Hans meeting there. A lot of souls sitting there. We go back after this experience of duality here. And we enjoy our house. Non-duality means so much for us. Because we have seen duality. And they are all dancing, singing in their routine way. We dance and sing much more than them. They say, what is so special about you guys? You just come from another world of pain and pleasure and so on. What is so special? We tell them, you don't know what you're missing. You don't know what you're missing in your true home. You've never seen anything to appreciate what you have. So therefore, this whole principle based upon the ability to appreciate. The ability to appreciate is a conscious ability. It's an ability built into consciousness. That we appreciate, love goes with appreciation too. The appreciation comes with love. We go to God with prayers. We go to masters with prayers. We pray. When we pray, we sometimes want a result. I pray for this master. He gives it. Prayer was successful. I don't call it prayer. I call it good business. You put your prayer forward, you got a result for that. It's a good business. True prayer is not business. True prayer is you pray and leave it at that. True action, which is spiritual action, also does not require result. And yet action should be performed well with no expectation. Krishna tells Arjun, he says, only that action can be called yogic, where you perform your skillful action and don't expect the result. Yoga karma su kaushalam, which means your yoga, your action should be most skillful. Put your best skill in it and you've done it. Finish. Period. If you say, now what will happen to that? It's not yoga. Prayer is all the same thing. You indicated your state. Period. Don't make it business. Then prayer becomes a spiritual action, becomes a yogic action. So that is why in our relationship with the Creator, when we pray or we worship or we appreciate, these are all terms that we use in our relationship with the Creator and sometimes relationship to the Master. Because a perfect living Master as a human being is no different from us. He's born like us, lives like us, dies like us. He gets sick like us, gets medical treatment like us, eats food like us. He happens to be a man, does shir like us. Shit, shower and shave. He's just like us, no difference. And yet that person is different only in one way. That when he is amongst our midst, his consciousness is at all levels available. He's conscious at that very moment of a true home. He's conscious of the spiritual realms or Parbrahm. He's conscious of the causal plane generating all this. He's conscious of the astral plane, how the bodies are all functioning in the astral plane. He's conscious of the physical plane where he's sitting at right now. And he's operating at all these levels simultaneously. This definition applies only to a perfect living master, which means he should have consciousness of totality of consciousness, which means our true home. If he is little short of it, even one step short of it, he can't have that. Because when we make progress on the spiritual path, we do it in steps. In order to get the astral experience, we have to shut off the physical experience. You can't have both. We always have only one reality with us. The idea of creation was not to create shadows or screen films or something, but to create reality for us. We always have one level of reality. We go to sleep, dream looks like real and remains real till we wake up. When we wake up, dream becomes unreal and wakeful becomes real. We go to astral plane, that becomes real. The wakeful plane, physical plane becomes unreal. We go to the causal plane, that alone is real. Everything else is unreal. We go beyond the mind, what they call the Parabrahm, beyond the creation of the three worlds. We go to Parabrahm, the soul discovers itself, and that's the only reality. Everything else is unreal. Maya, mithya, illusion. Only one reality. It's only when we reach the top, we discover the whole thing was in the top. There was no outside creation at all. All these levels were there. When you get that realization and that awareness and that consciousness, that is retained at all five levels. And this is what the perfect living master has. So don't think that a perfect living master has once upon a time a certain experience he's come to tell us about it. When he talks to us, he talks from all levels. And that's a big difference. And that's the true difference between a perfect living master and all of us. We are living in one reality only. He sits in all realities, which he knows are all illusions. All realities that we think are reality, including our true home, is also illusion. It's a created thing. The truth is the creator, not the creation. No matter what, true home we can enjoy, it's still a creation. The creator is the reality, not the creation, no matter what creation it is. So therefore, it's a unique experience to be with a perfect living master. Because his consciousness is operating at all levels. And he can talk not by remembering something that he learned, but by what he's experiencing directly with us. When we are ready, such a person appears in our life, not by our seeking, not by our search, pursuing him, but seeking. Seeking inside, outside pursuit, it does not always lead to it. But it can be that you pursue in different directions. Now, this is a good place for pilgrimage. Maybe there is a good temple there. There is a good gurdwara. There is a good church. There is a nice place outside worshipping people. You go all over. That is not good that you go to one group of people saying, we are meditating. You go to another group of people. You say, master, some master says, I'll tell you everything. Now I can't tell you anymore. Go. All these experiences, they ultimately lead to your meeting a perfect living master by coincidence and by chance. He appears at the right time. And all of these things you have been doing is part of your progress on seeking. It does not mean that there is a loss. Oh, why did I waste my time doing this? I told the story to many of you of my friend, Trilokchand. Let me repeat it. Trilokchand was an engineer in Burma, now called Myanmar. And he was a very keen seeker. He found a Swami in Madras, now called Chennai, town of Madras, could give you true knowledge. And he so sold his belongings. He already had collected, very miserly person, collected 30,000 rupees. And he brought them to Madras to meet the Swami. Swami said to him, have you heard the story of King Janak? King Janak said that he wanted independence and freedom, real knowledge. And he went to Ashtabhakar. Ashtabhakar said, give me your body, give me your wealth, and give me your mind. I'll give you the truth. And Ashtabhakar gave King Janak the truth. The Lokchand said, I have heard the story. He said, I follow the same principle. Give me your body, give me your wealth, give me your mind. I'll give you enlightenment. Now, a man who was so stingy, For the sake of enlightenment, you're willing to give everything. He said, all that is yours. The Swami said, let's start with the money first. How much do we have? He said, I collected 30,000 rupees. He said, put all that 30,000 into my account. I have to start building a temple. And this man put all the 30,000 there. Then he said, now you have to give me your body. So he tried to teach him practicing this type of pranayama, a breathing exercise where he had to pull the tongue inside. He said, you can't use your fingers. You have to breathe once from this nostril, once from this nostril without using your fingers. The only way to do it internally with the tongue. So your tongue has to be cut from its tendons so it can twist around. And the Swami showed his own tongue. Like a snake, it came out like that. He said that the tongue should be twisted. And he underwent the torture for a month to get his tongue cut, and then his tongue would twist around, and he did that meditation. Now give me your mind and do these kind of different mantras at different times. He did all that. And he said, Swami, I didn't get true enlightenment. He said, that's all I could give you. Eventually, he came and became a disciple of this very master. This picture is behind me, great master. And great master initiated him. And he got very good results. And he was so happy. One evening, we were sitting together with the great master. And he said, Master, had I known that you are the one to give me true enlightenment, I would not have given those 30,000 rupees to the Swami. And great master laughed. He said, the Lokchand, you don't know. The day you came to me, I transferred those 30,000 to my account. He didn't mean literally. What he meant was, there was no waste. He said, you never waste your effort in seeking. No, I went to a guru who couldn't teach me this. All the gurus have performed their function, leading you to that point where you're meeting a perfect living master. And that is why these perfect living masters take into account all that has happened. They look at our karma. They look at where we are sitting here. What's the time ready for it? And it's non-judgmental, pure love. I'm very happy you joined me today. We'll have a break for lunch. And I'll come and see you about 3 o'clock again. Or 3:30. I'll come at 3:30.